Okay, before the panel, we have one more speaker, Rodney Hinds. And as you can see, Rodney is most definitely in the media, has, as sports people would say, a lot of experience in his locker to draw upon. So would you join me in welcoming Rodney Hinds? Thank you.
Good evening. Oh, great, lovely. First of all, I just got to say thank you to Kevin for inviting me here today. I must say, I think it was at the top of the year that you tried to get me here. I know you tried to get me here the year before. It couldn't quite happen. But you're probably the earliest Black History Month booking I've had.
But it wasn't a Black History Month booking. It was just a booking in October.
Oh, right. Okay, good. I like that. And that's an important point, you know. Black History Month, I've done a few talks already, obviously in the month of October, and we've got to try and keep the dialogue going, haven't we, from November the 1st onwards, because nothing's really going to change. Dumi's had his poetry, Diane's had a marketing and HR background. Sport is very much my thing. And sport, you have to talk about equality and diversity, don't you? Things are changing. In fact, I'm covering a game over the weekend. I'm covering Arsenal versus Everton. And there won't be many people in the press box that look like me, okay? Bearing in mind on the field of play, out of the 22 players, you might have a good half of those that come from my sort of background. I have to have a little chuckle to myself because I've got to phone my mum, who lives in the Caribbean, to tell her that I've gone to university at last. All right, because I didn't make it. I didn't make it. But that said, education, reading books and trying to make the best of yourself was always at the top of the agenda. Yeah, so I was doing that. I think Diane mentioned it as well, that reading books. I was very, very confident because the household I came from was very confident as well. All right. And my early images of black men, especially, obviously I had my mother as a black woman, strong, positive. My early images of black men were as follows. Muhammad Ali. You might have heard of him? Yeah, great. The Brazilian football team and the West Indies cricket team, which back then actually won test matches. All right? So those were my role models. So I grew up as a very young man in East London, confident in what I saw in terms of men that looked like me. Yeah? And that was a positive that I took forward. Those were my role models. And I'm happy that they were my role models because that's why I do the job that I do now. Because, you know, I go into schools and universities now and I talk to young people and I try and say to them, what you're doing in your formative years, especially at school, will and possibly have an impact on what you do as an adult life. Yeah. And I remember Muhammad Ali fighting. I'm a little bit older than I look, by the way, so I can refer to Ali the way that I do. I remember Ali fighting a young man called Ken Norton. Anyone remember that fight? Heard about it?
Yes.
And my dad was the real boxing specialist, but as a family, back then, we watched Ali fight. There was just one TV, and I was remote control. Yeah, I turned the TV over when things were happening on the black and white set. And I remember that my mum, you know, she'd finished cooking on the Saturday and we all sat down to watch the fight. And that was a fight where Ali got his jaw broken. And I looked across, my dad was giving it all of that, as men do in boxing matches. But mum was there and I could just look across and I'm a really young chap at the time and I could see a tear in her eye. And I know why that tear happened. It's because the hero that Muhammad Ali was to our family and to many people around the world had just suffered a broken jaw. She thought it was the end of the world. And that's when I knew that sport was important. And not just sport, because Ali brought more than that to the arena, but he was very, very important to me. Because if you've watched any of the documentaries about him, there was no education to talk of. And he went on to do, which I think most of us know, he went on to be an orator of special note. And while his boxing was important, what he did outside the ring was also important. So I was confident with him. I was confident that I could follow him because sport was my thing. Writing was my thing as well as a younger person. And I remember when we came to what we called options back then, Rodney, what do you want to go on and do with your life and career? And I said, I want to be a journalist. And I remember the teacher concerned laughed at me. And I decided to take the what I call the Ali stance. The Ali stance was, I'm going to go ahead and do it anyway. And I'm so glad I did, because if I hadn't, I might not be here today talking to your good selves. Because I think that what's important is that we get put in boxes and we have to fight our way out of them. And there was a man, Ali, once again, my hero and the hero to many, who proved that you could do something different. And that's all I wanted to do as a younger person. So in terms of the educators, what I would say is this, you know, you sometimes got to understand that not everybody's going to want to conform at the time that you want them to. Yeah? And I would say to those, and this might sound a little bit grand, those that have a dream like I did as a younger person, if it is different to the norm, that's okay. That's fine. Yeah? And I go back, because if you've got that dream, the one thing that I do remember my parents telling me is that you have to work hard. Yeah? Now, I'm in a fortunate position where I interview stellar names. Serena Williams, Thierry Henry, yeah? Lennox Lewis. And every time you engage with people like that, you, at the top end, you know about their successful stories, but there's always a backstory. And the backstory is graft and hard work and disappointment. Yeah? But they did go on to become champions. So I'm a product, actually, and my career is a product of being on centre court when Venus Williams wins her first Wimbledon title. Now, if you want to talk about difference, centre court, I can't remember who it was. I think it might have been the Belgian Justin Henin-Ardenne. Blonde, blue-eyed. Here is Venus Williams on centre court. And the only other person that looked like her was me in the press box. And you could hear the murmurings. And I think we all know what Venus has gone on to do. We all know certainly what her sister's gone on to do. So once again, it's okay to be different. It's okay to take up new territory and ground. Because you can succeed. But you have to ally that ability and that bloody mindedness, yeah, to hard work and graft. What's interesting about equality and diversity is that it's not a subject that's ever going to go away, because we'll continue to talk about it. I don't know if there is actually an end game. I don't know if there's a full stop that we'll be able to put towards it. But forums like this are important because we can knock it about, we can talk about it. And while there may not be a whole list of things that we can take away, from tonight, there could be just one thing we could take away, and that could be the most important thing of all, because we've got to get started. Football is my thing, of all the sports that I cover, and it's a little bit like life, isn't it? For football to succeed, you need to have goals. You take the goals away from Old Trafford, from Elland Road, from Emirates, nothing's going to work. So there have to be goals and there have to be targets. I'm delighted to be here. And the reason I'm delighted by here to be here is because I've grown as well. And we want to talk, one of my favourite equality and diversity stories is this. One of the greatest things I enjoy now is doing these sort of events. Going into schools. Not a day or a week goes by that I don't get an email from someone that says, I want to be a journalist. I've seen you've written books, I've seen you on the TV, I've seen you in the papers for X amount of time. And while I'm a very busy person, I will always get back to somebody. And I had an interesting scenario a couple of years ago where through a friend of a friend, a young white journalist approached me to work for the Voice newspaper. The Voice newspaper is 33 years old. It's here to serve predominantly African Caribbean community in this country. And here's a white sports journalist who was talented. And I must confess, for a couple of nights, I thought, can I employ him? I'll be honest with you, I thought, can I employ him? After 48 hours, I said, yes, I must employ him. Because it's about equality. Yeah? He was as good as anybody else on my team. Why should I not employ him? Yeah? And he's gone on to make a tremendous career for himself. So what I'm really trying to say is what we can help each other. We can help each other, but we've got to understand a few things. And amongst those things is that my profession, as I said earlier on, if you go into a press box, I've covered Olympic Games, I've covered World Championships, I've done the test matches, I've done it all. And there are so few journalists of my colour in there. It is changing, and it will continue to change. And I think one of the reasons it's changed is because it's an often used term, role model. As I said, not a day goes by, not a week goes by that I don't get that call or an email and someone just wants to know how they can get started, can they get some work experience, or what direction should they take? And I've been there for a long time now, okay? And it's nice that I can guide and push them, not necessarily within the Voice newspaper, but maybe to somewhere else, maybe a Talk Sport, maybe be a BBC. I've made my contacts. That's what half my job is about. It's about making your contacts and then hopefully sharing them with the right people. I am the product of opportunity as well. My very first job in a local newspaper, it was during the 6 weeks holidays as it was then, and I just literally knocked on a door. And I said, I want to work here. I had no idea what I wanted to do. I ended up being the proverbial gopher, getting up the ice creams, picking up checks. So once again, you've got to be prepared. If your dream or the thing that you're chasing doesn't necessarily come when you want it to come, just put it on the back burner a little bit. You might have to take a side road. As I say to some of the younger journalists, you know, if you want to get to Manchester from London, yes, you might want to take the M1, M6, but there are other A roads and other scenarios that you can do to get to where you need to get to. I've been with the Voice newspaper since 2000. I celebrated my 15th anniversary not too long ago. And I can tell you what, I wouldn't change too much. If there was no financial ramifications in life, I'd do the job for free because I'm doing what I love to do. There can only be some, the only thing that can be better is to probably be a professional sportsman or woman earning lots of money and gaining a profile. But I'll leave you with this thought. Richard Williams is the father of Venus and Serena Williams, and I've been lucky enough to spend time in their company, and especially in Richard's company. And if you know the story, you have these two young ladies who have gone on to dominate and rewrite the history books in terms of sport and tennis. And they were obviously got underway by their father, who now has stepped back a little bit. And he said to me that if he had the opportunity, he'd love to come to England and work with the Lawn Tennis Association, because he believes that there's enough talent here, black, white, whatever colour you want, that England, I know Andy Murray is Scottish, isn't he? He's Scottish when he wins. And he's English when he loses, yeah. But he believes, yeah, when he loses. There's enough talent, there's enough tennis talent here, because I picked him up from Wimbledon one day and I drove him through the streets of Brixton, and that's where he wanted to go in South London. And he said, there's enough talent and ability here, but it just needs to be nurtured, and he'd love to nurture it. And someone, would anyone at the Lawn Tennis Association give him that opportunity? The answer is no. But the point I'm making is that we all have talents and abilities, no matter what our diversity ranking or whatever boxes we need to tick. So all I'm saying is to the educators, there are some golden nuggets before you in terms of the people that you're trying to educate. Give them an opportunity, and if they're doing something slightly different, don't write them off. And in terms of those with a goal and a dream, go for it, because it can happen. Thank you very much.
We've got time for a few questions. Any questions? Okay, Claude first, then two, and then perhaps a third. No, then three. Okay.
Right. I'll save the answer backs that I had for, because I've got some answer backs to the questions.
Okay.
For this question, Rodney.
Hi.
I live in the north of England. I've lived in the north of England all my life. Whereas in the south of England, they're a bit more cosmopolitan, especially around football, like the West Ham's having Harry Redknapp and them kind of people, where black players got opportunities in the south of England. In the north of England, black people don't get them kind of opportunities. There's not many Harry Redknapps up here. Leeds United, as a football team, you know, even though some of our young guys from here have gone to play for England, they couldn't get to play for Leeds United. My question was to you is, how is it that black men were playing football in England but couldn't get through the ranks? But since the African groups have come in from Europe, there are more black Africans actually playing it with the prestigious clubs than there is indigenous black kids that were brought up here. First part of the question. Second part of the question is... You kept me waiting.
Sorry.
Second part of the question is the peach colour.
No, that's for Diahanne, so we'll save that for Diahanne.
No.
You got two peaches.
It's in reference to football. How is it that the England team, the dark black players, are minimal in comparison to the mixed race players? Even though it's been proved, for example, Andy Cole, a perfect example, won the treble, but he couldn't get to play for England, no matter how, you know what I'm saying? So, they're my two questions for you on spot.
Two fantastic questions. I was hoping that you'd make it even longer, your question, because I'm thinking. The first one, last week I was with Viv Anderson. I interviewed Viv Anderson in Manchester. If you don't know, Viv Anderson was the first black player at a senior level to represent the England national team. I think in any walk of life, you need pioneers, okay? So in terms of the Viv Andersons, the Garth Crooks, the Ian Wrights, the Andrew Coles, etc., they were in a time where the scrutiny factor was so strong that it broke some of them, okay? In 2006, I wrote a book called Black Lions, so I've spoken to a lot of those guys. So they were there, for want of a better term, to be shot at. If they didn't score straight away, you know, they never got another chance. I think where the African player has moved on, they've, to some degree, benefited from those guys, yeah? And I'm not saying that in a negative way at all, because that's how it goes. It's about time. So the African player now, so you've got the Yaya Torres of this world, the Didier Drogbas, excellent players, by the way. But they've benefited from, if you like, the path being made clear by the likes of the players that I mentioned earlier on. So I think it's about...
And the fact that they were willing to pay them £120,000 a year.
Yeah.
They wouldn't...
Different time now, you see. It's a different time now. You see, when Viv Anderson and co. were doing their thing, there was no Sky Sports. Yeah. There was no BT Sport. Let's not kid ourselves. The money in football is based on TV. Okay? So I speak to the Luther Blissetts of this world, the first black player to score a hat-trick for England. He could walk down a high road now and no one would know about him, because the emphasis on TV then, we weren't watching live games when Luther was doing his thing. Now you can stay home tonight. And if I was at home, I've got the option of six games I could watch, you know. So it's just a different time, and with a different time has come more scrutiny, more money. The peach question, darker skin players, is that what the question?
Within England,
national team. I mean, that's a really good one. I'd like to answer it this way, that the amount of mixed race players, if I can term it that, that's growing all the time, because we're in a society now where relationships weren't what they are, what they were, but they've certainly changed now. I mean, if you look around, not just in football, but you look at, say, Lewis Hamilton, you look at Jessica Ennis, it's just that I think that the world is evolving at such a pace in terms of relationships and cultural unions that now that's why we have those sort of players. Yeah? The darker skinned players, I was out in Madrid, will be the victims of racist abuse. So when the Spanish fans were doing their thing, if it was Emil Heskey, darker skinned Emil, he'd get the monkey chance, and they'd be a bit more vociferous than, say, if Ashley Cole was on the ball. It sounds like madness, but that though, there's levels of racism to what I call the racists.
Time's moving along rapidly, and I would like to invite the speakers to the table. I'm just wondering, Dumi, if you might do us the honour of a poem or a reading. Sure.
Okay, if you don't mind, can I ask you to, you know, we'll be speaking at you in a sense. If I can invite you to stand and we can do a piece together. This time I don't want to do a poem for you, I want to do a poem with you, if that's okay. So just stretch your legs a little bit and then we can do a poem together, if that's okay. Sure, cheers. Okay, so now, like I said, you know, hopefully we can do a poem together. We've had amazing, you know, messages, questions, and all sorts. I'd like us to do a poem. It's entitled Black, White, Brown, Mixed, So What? Like I said, we'll do it together. So when I say black, white, brown, mixed, then I'll put my hand up like this so you know when your beat is coming. And you all say, so what? And can I ask you please to say so what with conviction? You know? I'm quite loud, but I'd like to, you know, so hopefully you can drown me out. Yeah, shall we try that? Okay, shall we try it out? Black, white, brown, mixed.
So what?
Need I blow the vuvuzela, my brothers and sisters, to make you understand that a rainbow is a rainbow because of all its colors. I've been watching children play, watching them grow. They miss nothing and see everything. Everything by the color of skin color. Life in their eyes is like a big lollipop with stripes. Why can't we all be children like? Black, white, brown, mixed.
So what?
Oh yes, I'm aware of history, aware of its ugly faces. I am evil too, and its recycled phases breeding doom. I am. But history, just like the seasons, transitions with time. There are times of droughts, bitter winters. But just as sure as day will follow night, the rains will come. Times of plenty and plenty of sunshine. Black, white, brown, mixed.
So what?
Does it count? That I count as the minority of the county. Why does my blackness, whiteness, break the banks of they that are not gifted with color blindness, that see not beauty deeper than skin pigment? Carry they excuses hollower than elephant tusks that will not forgive the past? Their ignorance can be trusted to take more to the graves than flying bullets, and their hate to enslave more than binding chains. How better are they than cats and dogs that hate for the sake? How sad are we to feed off the hate ball, for goodness sakes? Black, white, brown, mixed.
So what?
So what, ladies and gentlemen, so what? Thank you so much. Thank you. Thank you.
You'll notice an interloper over here.
He's too tall.
Tom Fletcher, one of our very, very promising and exciting researchers who's doing a lot of work around race and ethnicity, in particular around cricket, and he's a northern Yorkshire boy that embraces his Yorkshireness. As I'm sure you'll hear. Dr. Tom Fletcher is going to be chairing the panel. So Tom, I'll be the timekeeper for this one. And so welcome. So those people who have, yes, please. So if you have questions, if you could put your hands up and Tom will take them.
Yes, why not?
Thank you for the wonderful poetry.
Thank
you. I was interviewing the Nigerian writer Chimamanda Ngozi Adichie.
Oh, I love her. Yeah.
And she was saying that she grew up in Nigeria. She said when she came to the United States, she had to, in a sense, learn to be black because she had to continually categorize herself as black, and everything was framed by racial debates. And I was wondering if you found in your work, when you perform in America and in the UK, if you're always asked to read poetry which is about race. And while that is incredibly important, is there a sense that can also limit a poet, a black poet, who wants to talk about landscape other things?
That's a very interesting question. We've grappled with this question several times at different events. On one end, there's this issue of, okay, for example, do I identify myself? Do I call myself a Zimbabwean poet because I'm from Zimbabwe? An African poet because I'm, African? A black poet because I'm black, But therefore, like you're rightly saying, does that put me in a box, whereas maybe a poet, an English poet is hardly ever referred to as an English poet. They are a poet. An American poet is a poet, period. There are all those kind of narratives, that then shape discourses in a sense. And I wish, like I said, it's things that I myself am, kind of trying to understand in my own journey. When I was asked this question, I think it was in Oxford, it's a different event, my answer then was, actually I refuse to identify myself as, the African poet is here. Because what I tend to find, I even find this even in schools, when they invite me to work with young people, it's a case of, the African is coming, bring the drums. Yeah. And so therefore, but when I send, I see myself as an educator. So when I send them, my idea of what, the day may be like, and suddenly they're thinking, it's not all drums and, we're actually, talking about serious issues. And then suddenly some kind of drawback, because that's not my place, that's the place for other people, if you like. I'm an African, I should just come and entertain, I reject that, for a start, I don't consider myself as an entertainer at all. I like my poetry to be engaging, but when people invite me to an event and say, "Oh, can you come, and provide us?" They usually say, "Provide us a little bit of poetry." I actually have a poem called "A Little Bit of Poetry," which answers to that. That's one sure way to make sure, to make sure I don't turn up, because I like to take my work seriously. I'm not saying entertainment is wrong, but I'm just saying, also there should be, we should also not lose perspective of the educational aspect of things. Yeah,
I think that question can probably be extended to both Diahanne and Rodney as well, in that do you tend to be, I suppose, wheeled in to speak on behalf of certain groups of people, to be representative of them? Because Diahanne, you openly said that, as a woman and as a black woman, you're, I suppose, in a privileged position to speak on behalf of certain groups of people. Do you frequently get asked the same question to go and speak in front of a group of white students and inspire them in the same way?
I do, only because I'm bolshy, and I won't accept that from anybody. And I've had many debates about that, even in certain things I've been asked to speak, and even when you look at when I've done speaking engagements, and your fees are different, and I know that because I'm not silly. I know my white colleagues who get paid, and you're saying, but I just did exactly the same. But I will shame them. I don't have a problem with that. I will let people know that that's not okay. And so I personally don't have that issue anymore. But you could see that they started to push you down a certain... You go and speak to those black people over there. And I'd say, I like to speak to women, or I like to speak to people, and I'll share whatever my story is or whatever I'm there to talk about at that time. So, but it happens all the time. It's just that it's not spoken about. So if you're part of the speakers forum, they won't tell you that you're getting X amount less than, your colleague. But it's an important issue.
Yes, you certainly do get pigeonholed. I mean, obviously, I work at the Voice newspaper, so I know who I'm representing there. I can do a lot more than that, though. I can be on BT Sport and ITV and talk Champions League football if they want me to. But I will get a call from a Talk Sport or a BBC if Luis Suarez abuses Patrice Evra, or if John Terry has a pop at Anton Ferdinand. What I do now, I don't take those calls. Because I'm better than that. I think they know that as well. I know that if there's an incident in the Champions League this tonight or last night, I'll get a call. But I don't take those calls anymore because it's a silent protest, really. I'm as capable of being on Match of the Day in a nice fancy shirt on Saturday and Sunday on Match of the Day too. But I won't get that call for that. And I'm as capable as Alan Shearer. Yes, he's played the game, but I'm just coming from it from a different perspective.
My question's all put towards Diahanne's talk. Thank you very much for the play talk, all three of you, by the way. Really enjoyed it. You mentioned 0.5% of professors being black women. What do you think are the barriers facing women in higher education? What's preventing them becoming professors?
I just think it's a culture. It is predominantly at the moment. White middle class men, and I think like in any across the, not just in universities, and you know, we face these glass ceilings and these barriers. I mean, I know one lady who happens to be one of the two who just happens to be a chancellor of a university, and she talks about the issues that she had to face, the unspoken things in the coffee room, and just the constant stuff that she had to go. But she's bulgy, so she just kept knocking and knocking down that door. I just think it's a cultural thing. And it's about women themselves believing that they have the right. And there was a study done the other day, and I spoke about it on an occasion, that us as women, sometimes when we're talking, we apologise. And you'll notice when I tell you this, we'll say something, say, oh, sorry, and then a man will take over the conversation and we apologise. And I'm thinking, what are you apologising for? Just say what you've got to say. So it's some of the things we have to look within ourselves and believe that we have the right to be there because we're educated, because we've done the job, we've done the hard grafting, and we're good at what we do. So it's a whole culture change.
Lady with the striped top on.
Oh, hi. So I'm a journalist student, and last semester actually I did a piece on ethnic minorities in football as well, and I did this in my local city, which is Bradford. And the issue that I was focusing on was the lack of Asian footballers in football in general. So I spoke to the club, which was Bradford City. I also spoke to some of the students at the college why there was a lack. A lot of the students argued that simply the reason why there's not a lot of them is because they immediately think that they're going to face backlash because of the fact that they're, you know, a minority. So that's why. And that's why they were in different professions, because they wouldn't progress in it. Whereas the Football Academy themselves argued that it was basically because they just never came forward and there was a lot of segregation in general. So what do you have to say about that?
What do I have to say?
Sorry.
Quite blunt.
I think that the Asian footballer scenario, if I had a pound for every time this came up, I'd be a multi-millionaire. I think that it's twofold. I think that there are obviously talented Asian footballers. Obviously. There are some barriers in football, but they're no different to the barriers that the West Indian Caribbean footballer faced many moons ago. I mean, you know, you had, Cyril Regis getting called up to play for England. And the day he got called up to play for England, he had a bullet put through his letterbox. He had a lot worse put through his letterbox as well, but I won't put you off your meals. I think there needs to be some bravery on both sides of the fence, with the football clubs, the academies, etc., etc., but also from the community as well, that if you want to go forward, male or female, Asian background, and be a footballer, you've got to go for it. It's that sort of profession. There will always be barriers, because no one can tell me with the huge numbers of Asians that we have in, say, just the UK, that someone hasn't made the breakthrough. But I think there's this perception, and I think some of the perception is right, that they will face barriers. But they need to step out a bit. So, for example, my greatest example in sport in recent times is Amir Khan. You know, I covered a lot of his early fights, and there were Asians in the crowd, there was his family as well. And while it wasn't the norm, it was a starting point. I don't know if it's been built upon. So I think the Asian footballer thing, I think the Asian footballer will have to step out a little bit and face what will happen. It's like gay footballers. No one can tell me with, 92 football clubs and the world we live in that there are no gay footballers.
Mm-hmm.
However, it's that, you know, we all know what happened to Justin Fashanu when he stepped out many, many moons ago. Has the world moved on since then? It has, but we still need someone to say, I'm the one, because there will then be this short-term vilification, and then we move on. But that's what the African and Caribbean players have had to deal with. So I think the Asian player will have to do that as well.
Is it right, and this is for everyone, is it right, though, to just advocate that black and minoritised ethnic people have to have broad shoulders? Is that sufficient?
Is it sufficient? I don't know. Mm-hmm. I mean, where I'm coming from, I was, and it's a different time, others may concur with what I'm saying, I was told that to be anything, to be, you have to work 4 or 5 times as hard.
Yeah.
I'm an older person now, and when that conversation was given to me, my dad told me that, but he didn't actually say, and then you're guaranteed something. Mm. It was just that you had to work 4 or 5 times just to be in the marketplace. Listen, let's not mess about. We live in 2015 and it's almost 2016, and while there is progress being made, it's not at any rapid pace. Like the question the lady asked there about female professors. There is progress being made, that we can have this sort of forum and we can speak openly. But it's still not moving at any rapid pace. So broad shoulders, I'd say yeah, because, you know, to be black, only you will know what that looks like and feels like. And if somebody else wants to be negative or have banter, yeah, you have to deal with that. So broad shoulders, I think, is a prerequisite for any success that you want.
Okay. Yep.
My question's really around recruitment within universities and firstly usage of search consultants. Leadership positions, and I just want the panel's perspective on that from a diversity point of view. And then in terms of the whole education, higher education sector, have the staff that work in higher education, the professional services staff, ranging from cleaners to staff working in marketing, admissions, registry. So I kind of want to move forward, I'm going to open up the debate. Yes, we do need more representation within the academic workforce, but we also need just as much representation in the professional services workforce in the university. It's already the first one.
Who'd like to start?
Using search consultants and how that might.
Diahanne, do you want to
promote or impact diversity?
Do you want to start with that? No.
No, there is. I'm a bit like Rodney. I don't know definitely what the answers are in. I'm a big believer. When I used to do a lot of the work within big corporations who had very interesting foundations, and to really strip back the whole process of everything was just a long process. So bringing people in is always good and gives a different perspective. But it's the people within the organisations that still have to do the work and strip everything back. So I'm not saying it's not a good thing to bring in that. I'm just not sure if I think it's one of the best ways forward. I think it's about what I said, getting your chancellors and everything to sit down and start that debate and having those open eyes. And it's about having a conversation, like you're saying to Rodney about broad shoulders. it is what it is. I'm not saying is it right? Of course not. But I'm not going to tell my girls, you don't have to work any harder. I'll be like, yes, you do. You know, and that's just the reality. They ask me, well, why do I, you know, but then they'll ask questions. They're seven. How come we don't see people on the TV who look like us? Interesting point. So it's all those kinds of things. I think it needs to start from the foundation, but I think it needs to start from within the university on all levels, where, you know, all the different areas of the university.
Jason? Just speak up a bit, Jason. Just speak up a little bit.
So I was going to say, sorry, the three of you have been fantastic and hugely inspirational. And I just wanted to...
Are you devouring me, do you?
Yeah. I just wanted to kind of find out. You spoke about kind of 5 years ago in 2009, nothing has really changed. So I think sometimes we sit on this kind of discourse and dialogue for a long time. So I'm always kind of interested to hear ways forward. So fast forward 5 years. Where do you think realistically will be, and what can we do to make things different? I mean, across all
awesome. I mean, for me, my area of business is changing, and that has been because there are a little bit more. There's a few more people who look like me, and also I'm a big believer in mentoring and going into different organisations, and there's a lot of schemes like that. I run them in my company, where we go out and we speak, you know, I speak to, from the CEO of Rolls Royce to whomever, and have those conversations. I mean, I was raised to have my own, so I only worked for 1 year for a company. I've always owned my own business, so I kind of had my own, can kind of make my own rules to a point. But I do go into organisations, I do go into schools, and I mentor across the board. So if you followed my work, I mean, I've worked with many people, and I know you know some of the people I've worked with who've gone on to be amazing examples of role models, in especially Kenny Maffedon, 18, arrested at 18, went to prison for six, you know, on remand for 6 months, and now has... sits at the political table and has debates and has write many reports. But it all starts with going in and mentoring, and he'll tell you somebody believed in him, and that's where it started. Someone said you can, and someone gave him hope. So I think it's all across the board, whether it's business, whether it's education, we have to let people know that it's possible, and a bit like Rodney said, but it has to start from somewhere. And many of the people, I mean, one story that Rodney hasn't shared, and I think I was so offended about media and how fickle it really is when it was the Olympics, wasn't it? And there was a protest, or it was something, wasn't it? When
the London 2012 Olympic Games, which was sold on diversity in 2004, 2005. Was held in Stratford, East London, so you tick a diversity box then. And then obviously, as sports editor of the Voice newspaper, I applied for an accreditation, and we got refused. However, a petition was started, not by the paper, by the way. A petition was started, went to the House of Commons, it went to the House of Lords, Boris Johnson.
Can you believe this?
And if you like, the people voted on their feet, basically. I had some very dubious characters ring me up and say, do you want to go down to the British Olympic Association and sort them out? You know? I can give you my answer later on. And no, but once again, you know, we got sidelined. We did eventually get in. But diversity, equality, where is it? You know, at the end of the day, you know, most people turn up to Olympic Games to see Usain Bolt. You know, you've got the Mo Farahs of this world representing Great Britain with an African background. You've got the rest of the Caribbean. So, you know, I have been shocked and disappointed sometimes with the lack of thought that goes into it. But we can't run away. We have to keep battling and doing that. And that's what I'm saying. I've been around a little while now, and I get great pleasure to see young journalists, black, white, young and old, male or female, that want to do what I do and have the ability to do it. And they probably wouldn't get the same chance at the Mail or the Guardian. But that's where they end up, invariably. You know, so, as I said, someone that looks like me, people just want opportunity.
Could you imagine?
I was going to say, boss, are we allowed to ask Dumi as well if we've got time?
Yeah.
Go on, yeah.
Okay. All right, okay. In 1 minute. I just wanted... in 0 minutes. One message from my experience anyway, and absolutely, you know, everything that has been said, I absolutely concur. But also I think there's a sense of taking responsibility and ownership. You know, I've been to many events where, you know, for example, 2 weeks ago here, Leeds Beckett University, very diverse university, there was an event on, you know, a workshop on the Congo. Where I turned up, it was a Saturday, and I was the only black person in the, you know, in the entire room. And I'm thinking, okay, where are the rest of the students? Where, you know, so there's a sense of there's need to step out of the comfort zone as well, because we, you know, there's a sense that ethnic minority groups as well can just complain, but actually when opportunities are there, sometimes we don't step out of the comfort zone and challenge ourselves. You know, particularly if we're in the university environment, you know, there are opportunities to contribute to research, to, you know, to find mentorship amongst the teams that are already here. Let's take advantage of those. You know, often you go into a place and they're the only black person there, and then you're thinking, where are they, you know.
And I think sometimes, like what you said, I mean, I really would urge you guys to follow Kenny Macadon, yeah, because his story is interesting, and how he got a scholarship, and how Amos Bursary, and the fights as a black young boy, and then even though he was found not guilty, he was, you know, the judge acquitted him, the struggles, but what he decided to do, he for once put in a pen to paper and wrote a report, and he challenged government on many of the stuff he had to face, and those reports are spoken in Parliament today. We just had the last one, the third, it's on the third report, it's just finished now. But what it says to you is you do have to challenge yourself. And it does come down to someone believing in you, and you believing in yourself, obviously, but someone in believing you. So I do think it's about challenging ourselves and going about something differently, because his reports now are there in history. I mean, Prince Charles had debated, and he was not backward in coming forward about what really goes on in our prison system, what really goes on in education, because he's a bright guy. I mean, he graduates, you know, he's got a 2-1, and he went on to do very, he's going to go on to do very well. But, yeah, it's an interesting debate.
Got time for one more? Yeah?
One quick question about the diversity topic, because I need to give an example. I worked for a consultancy in sustainability, and I was hired to take the box of diversity in that company. Mm-hmm. So I was black and I was a woman.
Mm-hmm.
Well, I wasn't disabled for them, so they would be happier with me. But what I mean is, even in this company where they were talking about sustainability, they didn't prepare the environment. Let's say they weren't prepared to actually put in action diversity, like giving space to different voices, to different ways to think, and so on. So my question is, working with diversity with so many companies, what is like the challenge of explaining diversity? Because sometimes it can be really tricky, because people just think, oh, I just need to hire women, or just black people, or disabled. But they don't understand the complexity of the word diversity. My next question is, I'm sorry, but I need to... It's like... I appreciate that you said that one of your role models was like a Brazilian players. Yeah. But many of these Brazilian football players, the black ones at least, as far as I know, they just get really, really rich, and they don't go back to their communities, sometimes to visit, sometimes to buy drugs, that we know, but not really to help. And as a black Brazilian girl, I don't want to have only soccer players, football players as a role models to me. Not only because I don't really care about football, but it's not that. It's because I want to see other role models in TV or in society. I want to see business women, black women. We don't have that in Brazil. So I don't think it's enough. And I don't think it's enough not only as football players, but also as members of black community. And that's why I'm doing this question, because you say, work hard and go for your golden dream. But do you think it's enough when, the police is actually putting into practice a genocide against black community, not mostly men, but how black women are have to face the psychological effect of violence every day, and going for the golden dream. It's way too more complicated than just working hard. You know what I mean? It's like the black community is, as far as I understand, is a community of caring. We need to care for our mothers and our sisters, our sick grandmothers. And it's not really easy to go to university when you're psychologically affected for all these other inputs that we're not equal. So how to promote this equality? You know what I mean? Just working hard, sometimes it's not enough. You know, that's what I, and what do you think it would be enough? Not only.
You don't need me to summarise that, do you?
No, I think,
thank goodness.
The only thing I would say definitely about what you said is it's a serious problem. I mean, if you take the BBC, now I will just talk candid, and they will say to you, we don't want to put certain programmes on which have black people, people from the BME community, because it doesn't really sell. We don't get the ratings. That's, you know, let's just call a spade a spade. That is what they think. So for people like you and I to say, well, actually, I would like to see someone who looks like me occasionally and who's not a drug dealer, who's not a gang member. You know, so people, you know, if you're going to watch things, don't get me wrong, I understand entertainment for what entertainment is. But Top Boy, when Top Boy was on Channel 4, it got the most viewings. It was a hit. People like you and I watched it, and we watched it with our eyes open. But it was all about gangs. Yeah? Now, those same actors, and some of them I've worked with, those same actors, if they want to do a Shakespeare, they're just as qualified, but want to do a Shakespeare or be a role of a judge or something that's very, very positive, they don't get the roles. So this is what I'm saying. I agree with you. It's a but that's about lobbying. Me, personally, there's certain things I will do, like not pay for certain things. I will put petition together. You know, because me just moaning about it is not going to change what really is going on in places like the BBC. Media is so powerful of what, you know, you talked about up north and south, do you know what I mean? When if you're not, like, in London, we see loads of different, it's very diverse and cosmopolitan. But if I'm up north and I just keep seeing these images bombarded at me, it's going to step me, I'm going to have a view about certain different communities. You know, so it really goes from the lobbying, the political, the reports, which I'm saying, writing reports, making serious change, where when you get to the table of the people who do make those decisions, it's like, my child's disabled. There was an issue about her schooling. And they told me a load of rubbish. I went to the educational minister. And yet I do have power because I am in media. And I said, if you don't, you know, and I took his own report and ripped it to shreds. My daughter is in the school she wanted to go to because I took the knowledge, did my research, and I lobbied the people who have to make those fundamental changes. So I must admit, these things are great, but it's from all these kinds of forums, you take those findings or suggestions, you put it into a report, and you have to lobby the people who really carry the purse strings and who really make the decisions you know, for the whole of the UK. And it's the same for media, you know, football, where he knows my... I love football. Rodney and I will talk about football. My father was a sportsman and won the belt. I come from a sporting background. But football, we went to a thing once. Do you remember kick racism out of football? It's a talking shop. You know, and then because then I spoke up, the lady came up to me and said, oh, could you really do some work for us? I'm not your puppet. Because if you really thought that, you wouldn't be asking me. There would have been a representation on your panel. It didn't reflect. You're talking about kick racism out of football. But the panel didn't reflect that. That's why there's only, what, two managers? Two? One?
About five now.
Yeah, ooh. See, I just think that's what you have to go down to the fundamentals.
Can I just say one thing? Being in London, it's good because you can catch a tube and go to Westminster.
But not me. I live just outside of London.
So you can, in London, you can effectively sometimes make things happen because you're in the capital. We're 200 miles away from the capital, and sometimes to get that same kind of movement and impact is 10 times.
Well, I agree with you, but you know what? With all no offence to you or anybody, that's hogwash. Because if you're that passionate about something, you will go that 200 miles. And with the things like social media can shut down things. But everybody, but what I'm saying is everybody has to really put pen to paper or mouse to mat, you know?
I was going to say it's a shame that everything's hotting up. I think we've got to draw it to a close,
people,
haven't we?
People have got homes to go to. Yeah. If you want to run it for a little bit longer. Can I get a sense of who wants to go? Who's going home? Just put your hands up.
My wife's people. Very angry.
But okay, perhaps I can wrap things up. And if anybody wishes to continue speaking with our panelists, they can do so. The broad shoulder thesis was an interesting one, wasn't it? Because clearly. Clearly, we have to work hard to get what we want. And, you know, I was brought up, and I realised in my later years, because I didn't get this at school, but after school, that I really needed to work two or three times harder than my white counterparts to get on a level playing field. But that notion of just working hard has also got to recognise the kind of systemic racism and institutionalised inequalities. And it was great that we had Peter Slee here. He's absolutely brand new to the job. So he was initially down to do the VC's response at this time. But if he was here, I'm sure he'd be saying that I'm sure he'd be saying that in addition to working hard, that people like him, the Vice Chancellor's group, the academic and service and support constituency within Leeds Beckett University and in other higher education institutions have to do better. They have to do better, and they have to work towards, for example, the action plans that have been established recently through the Race Charter Mark, and they have to keep moving the university forward in that respect. Diahanne talked about a need for open and honest discussion, and for people not to get defensive when we have those discussions. We're not angry black people. We're black people who are critical and wishing to have an open and honest discussion. So we need to strip back, you know, a lot of these defence mechanisms to have those open discussions.
Can I just ask? I'm sorry, but in that scenario that you just described.
Yes.
I found that sometimes it's not the black people that are defensive. It's
no, I wasn't talking about the black people being defensive.
When you're challenging or having these open conversations,
yes.
Sometimes perhaps it's the lecturers or the teachers that become defensive when you ask questions.
Mm.
A lot of interesting and inspiring things said here this evening, but the one thing that's stuck in my mind throughout the whole evening,
yes,
is when Diahanne said that, you know, in this, lots of black people or students are leaving,
mm-hmm,
and we don't know why. Why don't mm-hmm we know why? Do we not have exit interviews, or is that part of the action?
Well, we do have some very interesting work work that's been done, and Jason, who I pointed to earlier.
Amazing.
The work that he's done recently with through the Runnymede Trust and Claire Alexander, and other work that's been done by people like Calwant Bhopal, the people at the University of Birmingham, in particular, Dave Gilborn, Nicola Rollock, Paul Warmington, their work kind of clearly identifies some of the factors that are causing levels of attrition or disgruntlement with higher education amongst black and minoritised ethnic students. They're not all the same, because we're talking about a diverse group within itself. But there's clearly reports there, very recent reports, that will give you more information on this perennial phenomenon. It's not a recent thing.
Mm-hmm.
But as I say, time's moving on at a lick, and I'd really, there are some people that I really would like to thank for this evening. So in addition to our speakers, Rodney Hinds, Diahanne Rhiney and Dumi Senda, I would also like to thank the Race, Equality and Diversity Forum and the Equality and Diversity team for all of their hard work in organising this event and other events. So perhaps you could join me in thanking all of those people. And perhaps even sending a really nice tweet out to I don't know what I've done there. Perhaps sending a nice tweet out just to let other people know that you've been here, that we're trying to do bigger and better things at Leeds Beckett University around race and race equality. And hopefully you'll stay engaged with our annual programme of activities. And if I don't see you before, I'll see you at next year's event. So thanks again. I've been really bad as a chair because it's 12 minutes past 8.
We were on time until you started talking.
They were on time. So I'd like to thank you for coming, and please, if you need to speak to any of the panel members or myself, come to the front and we'll continue the conversation. So, but thank you for coming, and if there's any food left, please take it home.